Our new topic, cell communication and homeostasis. Cells and cells use all this kind of communication, different ways of communication. We're going to talk about all of them in this class. So the first two, electrical signal, neurotransmitter, both of them were used in neurons. So neurons, they use the electrical signal called the action potential to transduct the signal in the cell. And between neuron and neuron, they release the chemical signal. That's the neurotransmitter. So the electrical signal is a long distance, but neurotransmitter is actually a short distance because between the neuron and neuron, the gap called synapse is a very small area. It's a nanometer range, 10 to minus 9 meter. Hormones, that's the chemical signal released by the endocrine cells. It need to be carried by blood, so it's a long distance communication. Paracrine, these are chemical signals released by cells. Instead of travel by blood, they just release locally, so their neighbor cells will pick up the chemical signal. And in your digestive system, they communicate, a lot of them go through the paracrine. Chemical signal, that's the summation for all the chemical, all the ligands, like neurotransmitter, hormones, paracrine, they all belong to the chemical signal. Gap junction, that's the structure to glue the cells together. So they were first identified in epithelium tissue, like your skin. They glue the skin cells together, so when I pinch your skin, I won't be able to take a piece of skin off, so they all glue together. And in the junctions, they have, if you took anatomy, you learned, they have the desmosome, the gap junction, the tight junction. So those junctions are the pin to pin the cells together. In the three kind of junctions, one of them is called the gap junction. Its main function is not to pin the cell together, but provide the opening. They're like the ion channels, but they're always open. So they provide the opening between cells and cells. And when the first cells, say they generate electrical signal or they have the chemical signal inside the cell, they can go through the gap junction, go through from the cell 1 to cell 2 to cell 3. So the whole skin cells, they work like one unit. And gap junction is first identified in epithelium tissue, but gradually they've been identified in other kind of tissue. When we talk about the cardiovascular system, your heart, your cardiac muscles, they also use the gap junction to connect them together. And when the first heart muscle, they generate action potential, and the ions are able to go through the gap junction to go through the first muscle to the second muscle. So it turned out the whole heart, they work like one cell. They all fire together, generate action potential together, and they are able to contract together. So these are the different ways the cells communicate, and we're going to go through all of them in this whole class. And let's look at some terminology. So the first is called the target cells, and these chemical signal released by the cells, they're going to reach the target cells, so their target. And these target cells have the receptor for that chemical signal, and these chemical signals called ligands, like a neurotransmitter is a ligand. Hormones is a ligand. They're going to bind with the receptor. So those cells with the receptor, they are the target cells. And these receptors have specificity. So each receptor only responsible for that one kind of ligand. Like the hormones, like every kind of hormones, you release insulin gonna bind with the insulin receptor, so it won't bind with other kind of receptor, so they have specificity. Also, they have a competition, so when you have too many signals, the receptor have binding site, so it's like a limited seat. So every time you have limited seats, they can be saturated, so they can have competition, they can have saturation. And a lot of them have allosteric modulation, like they have a different binding site, not that binding site, they have different site. And some toxic molecules, chemical molecule can bind with that allosteric modulation site, can change the structure of that receptor. And it turned out the receptor become more or less, most of the time they become less sensitive to the ligands. That's the allosteric modulation site. And the ligands, they have the agonist, antagonist. These two words come from pharmacology. So the agonist is the ligands, or a chemical molecule can be synthesized. You create a drug. It can bind with the receptor, and it can trigger the response. We call the agonist. Antagonist is a chemical molecule, and it will bind with the receptor instead of trigger the response. It block the response. So these two words they use in pharmacology a lot. And in this class, we will talk about the beta agonist. We'll talk about the cardiovascular system. It's the way to trigger the response of sympathetic response, mimic sympathetic response. And the beta blocker, also called beta 1 antagonist. You may hear this beta blocker. We all know it's hypertension medicine. And the reason is it's going to block the receptor. And so it will decrease the sympathetic response. So it turned out it can decrease the blood pressure. So beta blocker is actually a beta antagonist. It is the hypertension medicine. So these two words, agonist increase the response, antagonist decrease the response. And activity can be upregulated, downregulated. So these two words come from the molecular biology. So the receptor, the proteins, when it binds with the ligands, it will activate the cells, and it can be upregulated. Upregulated is you put more protein onto the cell membrane. So these proteins, they stay in the cytosol. Upregulated, like you put more glucose transporter, like the insulin, will upregulate the glucose carrier. So you can bring the glucose carrier from the cytosol to the cell membrane, and suddenly you have more glucose carrier, you can transport more glucose. So it's an example of upregulated. You can downregulate it. So instead of putting them on the cell membrane, you can pull them down to the cytosol, and it will decrease the cell's response. So the upregulated, downregulated, originally their meaning is you bring the receptor bring the protein, the carrier, from the cytosol to the cell membrane, or bring it down. But gradually, people use them to explain this will increase the cell's response, and this is the ligand will decrease the cell's response. The signal used by the cell can be chemical, can be electrical, like the neuron. We'll talk about the neuron, they use electrical signal. Also, muscle use electrical signal. And they can be chemical. Chemical is the ligand. So chemical molecules, neurotransmitter, hormones, paracrine signal, they all belong to the chemical. And it can travel for short distance. It can be the long distance. Like the hormones, they travel through the blood. So it's a long distance. And the short distance one, like the neurotransmitter, because it's released in the synapse. Synapse is very short distance area. And these chemical molecules can be lipophilic or lipophobic. So they can like lipid or they don't like lipid. Remember in the first lecture I tell you is that your cell membrane make your life complicated because cell membrane is semi-permeable. And it turned out the chemical molecule, if this molecule is lipophilic, it's made of lipid or is lipid soluble, and it has no problem pass through the cell membrane by using simple diffusion. So we talk about that. And the receptor, you can put the receptor inside the cell because they can bind with the receptor. And lipophobic, if this chemical molecule, this ligand is lipophobic, well, you're going to have problems if you put the receptor inside the cell because this molecule won't be able to pass through the cell membrane and it will never bind with the receptor. So the receptor can have intracellular and the membrane receptor because the ligands can be lipophilic or lipophobic. So if it's lipophilic, you can put the receptor inside the cell. So this would be the intracellular receptor. If it's lipophobic, well, you have to put the receptor on the cell membrane. It's a membrane receptor. So we have two different kinds of receptors. And this picture shows you what I just explained because of the ligands. So if this ligands is lipophilic one, it's made of lipid like steroid hormone, and she has no problem, use simple diffusion, go from high concentration to the low concentration area. Simple diffusion is the mechanism. So it will go into the cell from high to low. And you can put the receptor in the cytosol. So that's the intracellular receptor. And it will trigger the response inside the cell. For the lipophobic molecule, like this molecule, they have difficulty dissolve in lipid. And the cell membrane is mainly made of phospholipid. So this molecule have no way to go through the cell membrane. If you put the receptor inside, the ligand will never bind with the receptor. For the lipophobic signal, it will bind with the membrane receptor. And then this membrane receptor will do something to trigger the cell's response. And sometimes you found the intracellular receptor, they are in the cytosol, and sometimes they are in the nucleus. They are very close to the DNA. So when they bind with the receptor, and they will directly trigger the gene expression, they will trigger the new protein synthesis. And the same membrane receptor is for lipophobic ligands. Okay, so intracellular receptor, that's for steroid hormone or lipid hormone or lipid behave like lipid, like thyroid hormone. Thyroid hormones are T3, T4, they're released from your thyroid gland. They are made of one amino acid, so they're amine. We call them amine, A-M-I-N-E. And technically, they are made of amino acid. They should behave like proteins, right? Peptide hormone. No, they actually behave like steroid hormone. So they use simple diffusion to go through the cell membrane. So steroid hormone and thyroid hormone, they use simple diffusion. They can go through the cell membrane, and you put the receptor inside the cell. So they have the intracellular receptor. And when they bind with the receptor, because they are so close to the nucleus, so they can go into the nucleus and trigger transcription. So they work like transcriptional factor. And we'll talk about the membrane receptor later. So let's take a picture. Look at the picture. This explains what we just said. So for those steroid hormone or lipid soluble T3, T4, those thyroid hormone, they've been carried by blood. All the hormones being carried by blood, but these guys are lipid, so they have difficulty dissolve in plasma. Plasma is mainly water, and they need the plasma protein to carry them. So in your plasma, you have some plasma protein, and you get immune shot. You have antibody. That's one kind of plasma protein, and the second kind of plasma protein, this function is to help to carry steroid hormone. So these are the one carry steroid hormone. So they will carry steroid hormone. They need helper of the plasma protein to help them. And when they go to the target, they will have simple diffusion. So this is simple diffusion because they have no problem goes through the cell membrane. And they will bind with the intracellular receptor. Sometimes the receptor is in the cytosol, so it depends on the receptor. And when they bind with the intracellular receptor, they're so close to the nucleus. So they will go into the nucleus and work like a transcriptional factor and trigger the transcription. And produce the mRNA, then translation, produce the amino acid sequence, and turn out you're going to have a new protein. So for the intracellular receptor steroid hormone, your thinking logic, if you find, okay, they have an intracellular receptor, you should think one step back. This must be a steroid hormone or lipid-soluble hormone, and they need a plasma protein to carry them in the blood. And they will work like a transcriptional factor, and their end result is usually new protein synthesis. That's your whole thinking logic. And now let's look at the membrane receptor. So this kind of the signal could be ligands, chemical signal. They are non-lipid or non-lipid soluble. Actually, a lot of the chemical signal belong to this category. So they are peptide hormone or other lipophobic signal, like all neurotransmitter belong to this category. And this kind of signal, they could not bind with the intracellular receptor. They have to bind with the membrane receptor. And this kind of membrane receptor, they will have some way to trigger the cell response. So they usually activate the second messenger system. Okay, let's take a short break.